Okay, good. So for invitation and introduction, and for me, great pleasure to talk about this subject to you. I thought how to present the talk. First of all, this high temperature superconductivity results, of course, great expectation from BCS theory, from prediction of theoretician like Ashcroft, also great, really great contribution from calculations, and of course experiments. So I want to focus on experiment as the final, I would say, judge of the phenomenon. Still, we should remember that physics is experimental science. So I believe that experiment is really important. So, but the experiment also should be reliable. That's the point. I always wonder why Ashcroft asked experimentalists about details. Why is he so curious about this? And for me, the answer was very easy, because he wanted to be sure that the experiment is right. And for right experiment, he can build some theory. Otherwise, to explain any fact is very easy. Okay, so I want to talk about experimental details more than usual, but of course I should start from the beginning, from general, to introduce this high temperature superconductivity. Just starting from the beginning, this experiment also always, nearly always, is driven by theory. Even superconductivity was, in fact, is results of checking of predictions of how resistance behaves at very low temperatures. And Cameron Onnes, he checked it and found that platinum, for instance, behaved flat at low temperatures. But he thought about this impurity, so maybe impurities are responsible for this. And he selected mercury, because mercury at that time can be done very pure metal. And to his surprise, he found superconductivity. Later on, he found superconductivity in other elements. And after that, this big race for higher temperature superconductivity started. And recently, for very simple, if room temperature superconductivity, ambient pressures, so technology and common world would change dramatically. But this is very slow process over one century, critical temperature increase not much. And we'll talk about this dramatic increase in critical temperature in superconductivity. What I want to tell that it's interesting that, first of all, a long time, 50 years, were no theory for superconductivity. It was a really puzzling phenomenon. But that appears a really great theory, one of the greatest in the physics, Bardeen Cooper Schlieffer theory, which explains superconductivity. And it seems that afterwards it should be king on this plot. Understanding should help where and how to find superconductivity's higher critical temperature. But it did not happen. It's really surprising. I believe that only in this case, this experiment showed that BCS theory was right in expectations that high temperature superconductivity is possible. But before, it was really torture to find new superconductors, and Bert Macias was the main, I would say, visible player for searching of new superconductors. And he mentioned that in spite of all these efforts, it's only temperature 25-30 kelvins is something visible, but room temperature remains a pipe dream. And also he was really very much disappointed with BCS theory, which should predict high critical temperature, how to find, but it doesn't. So in this area, error was only around 30 kelvins. Yeah, of course, he was a great man, and he's left after him a lot, in particular, some understanding how to do science. By the way, he, you see here, avoid hype, give credits, and so on. But he also knows, well knows that for expression, be away from theoreticians. And nowadays it looks like ridiculous because in our case, a theoretician played very much role in this story. But he was right in sense that still experiment is the most important thing. He believed in Ayuso. So about how, nevertheless, high temperature superconductivity was found. This was started from very far away from metallic hydrogen, was predicted a long time ago. And metallic hydrogen, of course, is very interesting itself. And this is the subject of my main subject for our studies. And here predictions, what is important for the first story, that hydrogen could be high temperature superconductor, even room temperature superconductor. It can be superconductor in molecular states and atomic states. Critical temperature could be room temperature or above. Of course, it's also interesting for other exotic properties, but I don't want to stay much on metallic hydrogen because it's really deserve much more attention. Just yeah, I want to mention our some results on metallic hydrogen. For instance, we measured properties of hydrogen up nearly up to 5 megabars, and also measure what is most important, electrical measurements of hydrogen. So here, sample of hydrogen with 4 electrical leads, and we observe this funny temperature dependence of resistance. And we found first time this temperature dependence long time ago. And we confirmed it and continue to confirm all results that hydrogen is in fact transformed to metal in some different particular way, just for because of closing of band gap. Here around 350 GPa, there are recent predictions with recent calculations after our work. And this calculation explains a lot our and other experiment. So how it relates to our subject? It relates very simple because to reach superconductive, still we don't have superconductive hydrogen. And to reach superconductive hydrogen should be very high critical temperature, pressure, at around 5 megabars. And so people thought a long time how to substitute metallic hydrogen in hydride, because they found, for instance, in palladium, hydrides easily go inside of palladium. So maybe, and even so, hydrogen inside is an atomic state. But in fact, it's a bad model for metallic hydrogen. Ashcroft proposed something different, and he proposed to search for metallic hydrogen, high temperature superconductivity, and this covalent hydrogen dominate material like this, similar to this. And this idea was also too general, like BCS idea. You see, it didn't help immediately to find superconductivity because we try to study hydrogen rich compounds like this or this and so on, but found nothing. By the way, this also hydrogen-rich compound, which now after Zulu used widely in our field, but it doesn't metallize also, fortunately, for this application. So just direct following this theory doesn't work. What happened, fortunately, in the same time, it's development, dramatic development of crystal predictions. And so it was possible, different methods predict a lot of substances. And after crystal structure is known, it's relatively easy to calculate the rest. So phonons, electron spectrum, and calculate superconductivity. Because it's superconductivity is conventional, so it follows to BCS theory. And so it was a lot of predictions, and even a long time ago already, it was predicting calcium hydride, very high critical temperature. And this list now nearly 200 substances. So what, again, what experimentalists we can do? And I stop a little bit. Very recent paper like this, so shows that among 200 substances, they systemize it. And most promising for high temperature superconductivities, like substances where there is predominant covalent bonds like H3S or weak interaction between hydrogen atoms like lanthanum hydrides and so on. So experimentalists, we follow predictions and started with Z-lane. So one good thing, so we found that super crystal structure, people predicted very well. So it started from these years. And I really was shocked to see an experiment just as predicted. It was one of the first confirmation of the predictions. And next, superconductivity. And we, by the way, in this substance, people mentioned that our measurements of superconductivity are not right. In fact, it's right, because here you see very clear experiment which show for electrical measurements, no doubts that superconductivity is right, but superconductivity behaves like weird and not very high. So it's very interesting subject, but not as predicted. Aluminum hydride even worse. So we found superconductivity again very, very well structured. Structure is the same as predicted, great, but no superconductivity at all. Later on, it was shown that many things in predictions were not taken in account. For instance, in this case, large unharmonicity just kills superconductivity. So another calcium hydride, you remember that it was predicted again 10 years ago, and we immediately started to work on calcium hydride, but we were, for many reasons, very unsuccessful. So we could not reach metallic state, and even metallic state is always some kind of transparent, semi-transparent. So unfortunately, we failed with calcium hydride. But it seems to be now, with different techniques, people maybe succeeded because they observe superconductivity around what is predicted, above 200 kelvins. But so far, X-ray diffraction does not corresponds well to predicted calcium, predicted superconductive phase. So maybe likely that now there is multi-phase, so it's still a question for study. And some theoretical work very recently again just put in doubts that the structure could be a superconductor. So just more studies about calcium hydride. So again, we have a lot, a long list already had. So what can we do? What can we start? We started from not very representative hydrogen sulfide. I mean, I explain this simply again to demonstrate how experiment works. It's not like blindly following to predictions. And also we have a lot of uncertainties in experiments. So which substance can we pick up? Which is most probable, because we should spend half a year at least for any substance. And so here selection was also a little bit influenced by Yanmin Ma, because I collaborate with him on transparent sodium. It was very successful, and I know how they work very carefully. So I should rely on his calculations, because in this list, you never know basically how reliable, especially in the beginning, calculations are. So predictions was not very high in comparison with calcium hydride, say 80 kelvins, but with, and also substance is also not very good. Hydrogen sulfide is difficult to work with experimental, but we studied. And what we found to Alex Drozdov and me, this was his thesis work, and we found that this superconductive transition definitely because it's zero resistances goes to zero, and our experimental point here, black and blue, and they follow more or less predictions which are stars. Most interesting is, of course, after this, in this shadow, because critical temperature rocketed to higher degrees and we could not understand what is happening. By the way, this way still not very well understood. Akash recently, relatively, he proposed that it's some series of incremental transitions which increase critical temperature. But that time we had no idea what is this. And key was that one day we just pressurize at low temperatures to high pressure, and then when we warm to room temperature, resistance dropped, and after that we see clear steps at high temperatures, and this step reproduced. So after that we could walk and do science. By the way, again, we were very lucky in sense that immediately it was linked to theory, because at the same time it was predictions of superconductivity in this material. It's not our case because it's class right of hydrogen sulfide plus hydrogen, and predictions was like this structure, then this structure, and finally this remarkably simple cubic structure where predictions were 200 kilograms. And immediately as a theoretician accepted this structure, it was not confirmed yet experimentally, but structure is very simple, and immediately a lot of theoretical work appeared. I want to mention, by the way, that here we are very lucky that we did not know this work, because if we would follow these calculations, maybe we would never reach this phase, because one simple thing, that transition from this to this, it's around 1 megabar. But in fact, what we found later in experiments, that this phase CCCM exists at least to this pressure. In fact, maybe even higher, because of very big kinetic barrier. So there is some difference between predictions and real experiment. But anyway, we started to work. We have done immediately isotope effect, which shows immediately that we have conventional superconductivity, because phonons should be included to superconductivity. And here we have systematic study how critical temperature behaves against pressure and for hydrogen and deuterium. It's just empirically. So we have something, we have superconductivity, we have zero resistance, we have isotope effect. So what next? Next, we should demonstrate that it's superconductivity, except of, not only electrical, but Meissner effect. And Meissner effect, direct measurements can be done with SCID, just to measure magnetic susceptibility. And before RAS was this work developed up to pressure only, say, 20 GPa. And we need 10 times more, approximately. So it was a really tough problem. Fortunately, here maybe you see it. I hope you see it. Yeah, here, camera. So you see very small cell. I made it long time ago, really, very long time, just for curiosity, that when I realized that diamond and cell can be very small, I made it and never used it. But I remember about this and built very small cell like this, really like this. And this cell was really very successful, because we can do susceptibility measurements to now at 2 megabars and here at 140 GPa. And we succeeded with measurements of magnetic susceptibility. Here zero field cooling and here field cooling. These measurements are tricky, and I will stop it about these measurements much more detail in second part when we recently improve it, make it better, and but conform these correct measurements. As for measurements in dependence of magnetic field, so this hysteresis measurements, here we suffered really a lot because of background. So we have some in the beginning diamagnetic response, but then paramagnetic or ferromagnetic strong response. But nevertheless, so this hysteresis finished at dissipated at temperature 200 Kelvin, like should be in superconductivity. But still, these measurements are not good. We only could estimate first critical field here on this point, which is not right, not correct. And we stated in our paper that it's only very rough estimation of high critical point, first critical point. But again, I will stop here. We have done much better measurements now, but basically very rough, conformances. Also, next, we have done experimentally, we have done X-ray diffraction measurements. And these measurements conform for the first time predictions, theoretical predictions, exactly this AM3M phase. This was relatively, not it was already good measurements, but afterwards, there are measurements much better. You see also X-ray diffraction from this phase when this phase was created by direct synthesis from sulfur and hydrogen. So we confirm this beautiful prediction. And again, we spent a lot for study of this phenomena, superconductivity, in strong magnetic fields. And here you see magnetic fields, you see up to 65 Tesla, it was done in pulse magnetic field. In this case, this very small cell, which I showed you, in fact, was very useful for pulse measurements, not only for squid measurement, but pulse measurements too. And this is some kind of record measurements. And we have done 45 Tesla again, the strongest magnet in the world in Tallahassee. And as a result, we have very good, still we cannot suppress superconductivity because for that we should have 100 Tesla, we cannot do this. But anyway, we can extrapolate quite reliably to high magnetic field and obtain critical magnetic field. So about superconductivity, a very important point, of course, it was verification in other laboratories. Because our experiment was difficult to repeat in other laboratory in the beginning, at least, because we work with H2S. You see here a picture where we fill cell with H2S, here H2S with four electrical leads. And after pressurizing it above 100 GPa, it becomes metal and superconductor. We have done this experiment at home. And then, fortunately for us, Professor Shimizu invited me to his laboratory to check this superconductivity, this wonderful superconductivity. It's very interesting, curious. Is it superconductivity or not? And it's really good check. And spin rate is ideal and still ideal place for this because we can do superconductivity measurements and X-ray measurements at the same beam, which Shimizu built in Spring 8. And so, and then also we measure superconductivity, and here you see plot from you see Japanese device, and here you see zero, quite good zero, Japanese zero, which is better than everywhere. as usual. So, and also later it was, this was our sample, but later other laboratories also obtain the same superconductivity and publish it. For instance, here it was published. In fact, mostly it was Professor Shimizu did it, these experiments. And also, as for it was again, X-ray diffraction was repeated, and also magnetic susceptibility measurements were done with coil techniques here. Yes, and so this is about H3S. So it's a lot of work in our laboratory, as a laboratory experimental. I don't mention here, it's in general, I will not mention much theoretical works, which really extensive for H3S. It was studied theoretically very carefully in many groups, in many works, and with very good correspondence with experiment. So we also found superconductivity in hydrogen phosphide. This was not really exciting, very high superconductivity. But this is also interesting that predictions, they did not find superconductivity in pH3, and it was right because they found it pH2. And this was right because in our first paper, we did not publish when we annealed superconductivity dropped dramatically. So it's very independent test of our experiment. So we tried also dizzy lane and reach some critical temperature, but not very exciting critical temperature. And I skip a lot because a lot, many experiments started to appear, fortunately. But next, the decisive step was with lanthanum hydride. And lanthanum hydride showed even higher critical temperature, 250 kelvins. And what is remarkable also about this substance, it was different from H3S, because H3S is covalent system. You remember hydrogen is between sulfur atoms, but here some cage structure. So around lanthanum, there is hydrogen. And lanthanum does not work really. It's separated, just supply charge to network of single hydrogen. So in many respects, in very many respects, it can be considered like model of metallic hydrogen, it's like doped metallic hydrogen. That's very interesting also. And fortunately this was done nearly independently with Carnegie's at time group, approximately the same critical temperature. They, by the way, pioneered with crystal structure of lanthanum hydride with X-ray diffraction. And afterwards, it was very nicely conformed in some Chinese in paper here. So very good confirmation and correspondence, no doubt about lanthanum hydride. And I don't mention here, but this was also remarkable theoretical predictions, quite well reproduced. Of course, with some deviation, for instance, lanthanum hydride, lanthanum H11 was not predicted and so on. So next was very successful prediction lanthanum hydride. Of course, we had a lot of hope about yttrium hydride, especially yttrium hydride 9, which was predicted to be even room temperature superconductor. And so we spent a lot on this system. And here you see, as usually in hydrides, things are quite complicated. If we started with hydride, so you see it H and so finally it HN. And you see volume expand a lot. So X-ray diffraction, of course, very powerful method for study hydride. It gives even you see immediately you see big influence on lattice. And also, of course, we know lattice parameter. Lattice, of course, Euclidean, but it's already very good for comparison with theory. And what we have found here, just let me remember that we found, of course, yttrium H6, we found yttrium H10, and this is dependence on pressure. So in yttrium H10, we found this maximum around 244, something like this, kelvins. And we also studied deuterium, isotope effect, and so on. And so we tried to find this the highest yttrium H10, but failed to do this. Even by the way, it's experimental is very exciting because pressure here more than 400 GPa and temperature also 200 Kelvin. And these conditions we measure, I think here we measured X-ray, quite good X-ray, but unfortunately we did not find the predicted phase. So we failed with finding room temperature superconductivity in yttrium hydride, at least for now. Maybe still there is some conditions, another phase which has higher critical temperature. And in the Institute of Crystallography in Moscow, people also study in this case E3H6 and with very good correspondence with our results. So again, independent confirmation that there is superconductivity in this compound. Just let me summarize here. Of course, I skipped a lot. I mean, other substances which other groups did, simply because I want to go further. And here, mostly we have this cage-like structure and covalent structure like this. And you can see here some reviews and even more reviews where you can find much more. So second part of my talk. So it still looks like we have really overwhelming evidence that we have superconductivity. But still there are, but it looks like we have had done a really good job because it is attract attention and close attention. And so here, maybe you already noticed Hirsch, Marcy, Leo, they published a lot of paper and even today appeared in archive another paper. So it's a lot with criticism, which can be summarized the following. So from their point of view, what is lack in our experiment? Because we observe thermal hysteresis, which should not be for superconductivity. And also they claim that we don't have broadening in transition and magnetic field. Again, it's a gains of superconductivity of second type superconductivity. And finally, most important, absence of reliable magnetic measurements. Meissner effect. So let me just, first of all, I will not analyze every paper, but I want to concentrate on this three parts. But before this, because everything now become important, so how first most important is measurements, right? Or no? Just measurements. So measurements started from anvils for preparation, and so a few words how we do this. And I like this picture because it's scale from 300-year-old technique of polishing of diamond, like in India, boys, I believe, even now do this. And I do it routinely in our work. Not every day, but very often. Because we prepare anvils by ourselves. I do, basically. And second, on the as a contrast, we have also FIB machine, our own FIB machine. So we can do everything with diamond angle. For instance, here after cutting, we can do everything like toroidal shape or deepening, and also we can deposit electrical leads. So we can do a lot. It's very good device. So about experiments, let me just details, maybe it's interesting for how torture can be experiment sometimes. For instance, here we probe Z-lane or H2S in such a way. So we condense gas, for instance, H2S in this case, around anvils and then clamp it. And see, so you see picture of clamp sample and analyzes with Raman to be sure that the clamp right sample. Of course, it's difficult because you should pull down a cryostat. Difficult is also smell and poisonous and so on. And I don't mention Z-lane because we did Z-lane in the same technique. Z-lane also you should be very careful because it's really dangerous. And also don't frighten people because we should release gas after experiment and outside the building. So you see some fire near building at night. So therefore we walk at night, nobody saw it. So something like this, it's some colorful. And more detail about our experiment, it's more or less traditional now. It's two diamonds insulating gasket and we deposit four electrical leads. So we have four electrical measurements. And nowadays we don't do this torture condensing, but we can do H2S very simple. In fact, we followed, I don't remember who first did it, maybe Goncharov did it. So followed guys which just put sulfur and illuminate sulfur with laser and you see formation of sulfur hydride. And in this case, the deuterium, sulfur deuterium, which fills nearly whole hole. And here in more details, how to prepare samples. I showed you just before, it's in this case, yeah, also deuterium. And here you have very nice superconducting transition as a result of good preparation of the sample. And this is in work, I think Zhu did it. So it also was quite complicated to prepare this mixture H2S liquid and H2. But again, now it could be done much easier. For instance, in this work, it was placed in this case zelenium. Can you imagine zelenium hydride? It's also very poisonous. It's impossible to work with this, but it's possible to prepare very easily zelenium hydride. You see here, after being in oven at 200 Celsius, it forms very nice zelenium hydride. And yes, and I should accelerate still much more. And here also another nice method, you see here, it's post-placed sulfur and we illuminated with green laser and see this crystal shape hydride. It was done in laboratory of you. And here, next step, what Zulu in fact introduced here, this substance or paraffine or aluminum hydride, and we use it sandwich between this substance and here lanthanum or sulfur and illuminate with laser and have very good hydride. In fact, I should mention that it was an old idea, it was an old realization a long time ago. Poniatowski designed it for larger devices. Okay, so about electrical measurements, once again, we do this van der Poel measurements with four electrical leads. By the way, I realized that maybe not many people do it. Normally people do it like current and measure here voltage. But here in this case, we can change this sequence. And so in the result, we can probe different parts of the sample. And you see here, this is one combination of electron, in red, another combination. And you see in red, it's not as good step. And there are some bumps which clearly indicate that this part of sample is not uniform. And sometimes it's really weird shape of electrical, of superconducting transition. In one combination, it's more or less good. And here you see even so. So in fact, superconducting temperature should be done here. In fact, it's known, and here even ultimate case. It's strange, but superconducting temperature should be here according to this step. And it was studied, it's not just unique for this substance. In fact, it's known for other superconductors too. So it's again some kind of indirect evidence that we have superconductivity, one more evidence. Sometimes it's impossible to judge this as superconductivity, just for curiosity. What we observe in the beginning, we observe this new right superconductivity. But when you see this plot, we could not say that it's superconductivity, we just afterwards realized that it was like so, because sometimes superconducting steps is really weird. So you see here, of course, superconductivity, but the superconductivity here, it's not difficult to imagine. But when you have many experiments, of course, we know that this is correct, because we have experience with other samples and so on and so on. But I mean, even interpretation of electrical measurements, sometimes it's not trivial. And so let me start with the first critics of Hirsch. So they noticed that superconductive transition has hysteresis. And here, in fact, very small hysteresis, but normally hysteresis much larger. And so they concluded that this intrinsic properties of superconductors, and even if so, it's not superconductors. So the first claim that what we did is not superconductor. But of course, things are much more simple and just this artifact of measurements. And here, a very nice experiment which done by Velakiri, and but very careful. So this is our very small cell, which is this what I showed, very small cell. And this is good because thermal gradient are small, should be small also here, basically kappa alloy, which good thermal conductivity, thermal gradient small. But still there is, when you place sensor here, you see hysteresis. I didn't show you because it's, but believe me, there is. But most important is the following. So if glue miniature sensor to gasket, so you see here, this is practically no hysteresis. You see scale here, it's very small hysteresis, nearly zero. So it shows that how experiment should be done. And ideal experiment, but of course normally we don't have ideal experiment, but we do some control measurements, and our method of measuring common routine method of measurements superconductivity, what we do, we cool down relatively quickly, and after that measurements and warming is around 10 hours, and in this case sample is in equilibrium with cell. So in this case, sensor measurements are correct, and we confirm it. By the way, we confirm also in measurements in Shimizu's lab. He obtained the same data, the same critical temperature as with our thermometer. But of course, we should be very careful in every step with measurements, at least should be controlled and so on and so on. So temperature measurements, I think it's very clear that they are not right. And finally, what I want to show here, it's another, this very nice experiment was done by Trajan, and soon after my measurements, so they did so-called nuclear resonance scattering. So in fact, Mesbauer measurements. So there is sample of Stanon which surrounded by H3S, and the idea was clear. So let do if we cool down this. So when H3S will be superconducting, so it means magnetic field, which normally penetrate to the sample, will be expelled from sample, and we will see difference in the signal. And they did observe. And so again, it was not very clear from these measurements how it was done. It was again was severely criticized, but here, you know, and what we have done, in fact, it was done Prozorov and Butko, and they just did precise good numerical calculations how field, so they model again this field surrounded by H3S. The question is, will be a magnetic field inside? And calculations show that no magnetic field is inside of this sample, just a briefly. And they even consider more complicated case. So if this sample, there is some small submicrometer slit for some reason. So even in this case, magnetic field inside should be zero. But most important this case, just forget about slit. I think it's not reasonable, not practical to consider this complicated case. But definitely magnetic field is zero. Again, rough estimations of Hirsch. And finally, we should mention room temperature superconductivity in this system, which claimed by Snyder. So everybody know very well this work. I don't want to repeat too much it. So it's very interesting work. And what is interesting there? So first of all, very sharp transitions. And this sharp transition remained in magnetic field. What else? Of course, it's temperature dependence of critical temperature. Also very sharp, this transition. Of course, it's people wonder why it's possible, but okay, it's, let me show again. So let's talk about this, no broadening in the magnetic fields. In fact, first Hirsch and Marsh-Gilio notice this, and then Marvin Cohen and Dogan, they also notice that it seems to contradict to superconductor of second type superconductor. As I understand, it's not really fundamental, so it's not excluded that this very sharp transition, no broad is. But the thing is that it contradicts, I would say, nobody observes such in any other superconductor. So it's a question. And also Hirsch again criticized when we are not lucky. So all these questions about Diaz's work were transferred, projected to our work. So they concluded that all hydrides also know broadening. I don't know why they concluded, because clearly it was published here that you see by eye that, of course, this transition to broadening with magnetic field. I don't know how they can miss it. Very similar to magnesium barite. And very recent superconductors, which is published, they also show broadening. Of course, you cannot see broadening in many other superconductors when transition is broad. It's impossible to see broadening. And also, Talanse also noticed that in the system, you see this, there is dependence on critical temperature and critical magnetic field. And now it's a lot of many substances follow dependence, which just standard dependence, except again of H3S. So it's some questions. And also we notice that value of this superconductor, you see, it's always like very high. It's 1 ohm, 2 ohms. Normally we have milli ohms. Sometimes they also have it since millions. But anyway, standard is everywhere, 1 ohm, 2 ohms. It's too much because it's not good metal. And measurements are very good for probes. It's difficult to say the equation of electrodes. So it's a little bit strange that resistance is too high. And here also. And also, you know, it's for us at least was surprised that all the same group also published yttrium hydride, yttrium H9. Recently, yes, see here. And you see our measurements and also our measurement good correspondence with Trajan, but no correspondence with Diaz. And again, it's the same, they don't have, they don't characterize sample. I want to stress in my talk that we always characterize very well with X-ray what we have in the beginning. We have in the beginning Raman spectra, afterwards we carefully know what we measure. We know X-ray, we know structure. They don't have structure. They claim about structure from Raman measurements, which is ridiculous. It's nobody do it. And even more, in the toxic, and even not in toxic papers, they claim that X-ray diffraction is not good method, and because they have no information about hydrogen. Of course, no information about hydrogen, but you can estimate even stoichiometry of hydrogen from X-ray diffraction quite reliable because it's well known. And for some substance, you can do neutron, you know exactly what hydrogen and so on and so on. So it's science, it's evidence what you measure. But in this paper also, no, we don't know what is this. We don't know structure, we don't know anything. And this big problem for us. So when we saw this paper, we hesitated. Should we conform it, to measure it? And most, I would say, clever people said that it's useless because you cannot check it because you don't know what to check it because you don't know structure, you don't know what is this. But anyway, so if we try to follow just recipe to put sulfur and carbon, and if we would lucky, we can go to superconductivity and repeat these measurements, and maybe we'll be lucky to go higher superconductivity and study this very fascinating new superconductor. So finally, we decided to go in this business and regret about this because we spent a lot of time, more than half a year, much more, I would say. And finally, we didn't succeed. It doesn't mean that they are not right. I tell what I tell, that we could not succeed. What is, I would say, most irritated for me at least, what in this story is that when we measure, put sulfur and carbon here in hydrogen and illuminate with green laser. Sulfur react with green laser, as I showed you before. It's known reaction. By the way, they did not refer this work. But what is really puzzling is carbon. Carbon did not react with hydrogen at green laser. It's very natural because it's chemistry of carbon is well known in hydrogen. Nobody knew about this reaction. And even without knowledge, just all our attempt to create methane from some reaction carbon with hydrogen and the green laser, even green laser at higher power, and so we could not succeed. And so we start to think maybe we put not good carbon because carbon is different, 6 allotropes. And others did not specify what is carbon. And even they did not specify it after direct request. It's really impossible to imagine how. So what we poor experimentalists can do in this case without knowledge. By the way, I should mention here that this also not only a question for to the authors, but question of a publisher, just routine, because when I occasionally look in chemical papers, in chemical papers, it's routine, it's just standard. They describe everything, all details, so you can, so everybody can reproduce their reaction. But in our field, it's in this respect, by the way, Hirsch also right, because sometimes experiment described not very well, and it's very demands not so high, and so we should be should keep standards of experiment very high. Of course, it's not always easy to do, but we should try. At least in this case, we should know what is carbon, and we should reproduce. But in the beginning, we stopped. We cannot reproduce this. So afterwards, what can we do when we hit it with normal laser, with Young laser? Of course, when we hit it, it was erupted and created methane. So we tried this method. So we created methane and with laser heating. And also we did it at different pressures already, and even at very high pressures. And also we have experiment instead of creating methane from carbon, we also put mixture of methane plus hydrogen. So, and we in fact, we prepared paper about this, nearly prepared, I would say. So I hope we will post it soon. But result is the following. So our, this is stars and all this, our results of our measurements, and all them shows that the best is just pure hydrogen sulfide, always or lower critical temperature. This is for comparison DS results. And we should mention also that theoretical work, basically high level theoretical works, didn't also confirm, didn't find high temperature superconductivity in this system. Of course, there are two papers in collaboration with DS, which they claim that so doping with carbon allows reaching room temperature. But this paper, theoretical paper, criticized very easily with higher level theoretical calculations. They could not repeat that calculations. So that could not be considered like serious, I believe. So maybe that's it, but I should finish with something. I mean, future prospects and so on, and prospect, of course, there are prospects, even high transition temperatures, or there are predictions of even much higher temperatures. There are very recent predictions now that at some, I don't know if it's realistic or not, but for if this crystal structure could be realized, so in this case, critical temperature could be pretty high at very low pressures. And there are a lot of calculations which show that ambient pressure superconductor are possible at least at this in this critical temperature range. And now yeah, I mentioned already this 12 GPa. In fact, it was this ternary compounds was proposed already a long time ago, also pretty high critical temperature. So now we have there is hope on ternary, so to hope that calculations will help us to find reasonable way for at least relatively high temperature superconductivity. So and let me I apologize that too long talk, and of course I appreciate collaboration with my great group, great guys, and also let me just what I see here, a lot of people who participated or helped to this work. And I hope somebody stay here, so and will be questioned. Many thanks for your attention.
Okay, great, great. Thank you very much, Mikhail. It was quite a bit details from the history to the end. And it's clear that when we are dealing with superconductivity, we have to know the structure. And here we have to use a synchrotron facility to probe structure to be sure that what we are measuring physical properties is what we are thinking of.
Yeah, that's very obvious. That's very obvious.
Okay, now we are turning on to the question session, and Zulu, take over.
Yeah, I see Professor Hirsch has raised his hand, and rightfully so. Let's hear it from you, Professor Hirsch.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes. Thank you very much, Mikhail. That was a wonderful talk, very, very interesting. I look forward to see those new measurements on magnetization, hopefully very soon. I have a question on the following. The nuclear resonance scattering experiment that you mentioned said that you applied a field of 0.68 Tesla, mm-hmm. and the field was largely excluded from the interior of the sample.
Yeah.
On the hand, your 2015 paper, the figure for C or D on magnetization shows that the magnetic field of about 0.1 Tesla or so seems to be penetrating the sample.
Mm-hmm.
Seems to me those are contradictory. Can you tell me what you think?
Yes. I don't feel very comfortable about this explanation, because I did not do these calculations. But of course I should be responsible, but simply I didn't prepare well to answer this particular question. But we will post this article, I think, in days, maybe tomorrow, after tomorrow, because everything is ready. Just I am waiting for some small details. My understanding is that, as I remember, the question also is temperature, because at this particular temperature, field could penetrate.
I'm sorry, Kelvin, the experiment, NRS experiment, shows complete exclusion of the magnetic field.
Yes.
The field of 0.68 Tesla. And your measurement at the same 50 Kelvin shows that already at 0.1 Tesla, the seems to be a clear contradiction.
Let me ask you another way. So do you see some contradiction in these plots? This explanation is not enough for you?
In this paper, there is a figure that shows that the field inside goes to zero at 100 or so, at 50 Kelvin. I mean, you need to go to the paper and look at the figure. It, at 50 Kelvin, the field measured is exactly zero in this experiment.
Yes.
When the applied field is 0.68 Tesla.
Yeah.
And in your experiment, the figure four shows that when the field exceeds like even 0.05 or so, at 0.1 Tesla, it's already going in.
I don't know. I'm not ready to answer this question, because I really didn't prepare. Be sure that, of course, we will answer this particular question. I concentrated on this.
I'm saying
this model. I think it's reliable calculations, definitely.
Thank you, Mikhail. I don't see any other hands going up. So I think I want to, it's already gone 15 minutes past our closing time. I want to, say that this was a very great talk, which kind of looked at a lot of detail into the whole history of what has been recorded from your group, which is a spectacular amount of work. Thank you very much. And I'm sure that, we will have many more discussions like this going on, and I hope we can all you know, come to this kind of a place, you know, virtually, and you know, fight each other out and get all the numbers totaled up and this thing. And I agree with what Mikhail said, that to the outside world, it looks like, you know, this is a lot of magic, but it's not. I mean, it's very, very detailed experimental work which needs to be shared among us and discussed so that we can just present, you know, the whole data as it should be.
Yeah, sounds good. Thank you. So yeah, it's really nice when we talk about all the difficulties we have and how we can solve. And if discovery will continue discussion, it will be great.
I think Russ has a question. Yeah. Russ?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, thank you, Mikhail. That was a great talk. And just to follow up on what Zulu was saying, yes, this field is full of all kinds of complexities. And so if you're not deep into the technique, it may be lost on a lot of people. And I was especially pleased to see the many experiments you've done on lanthanum hydride, because we found huge sample variability, even within a sample in terms of measurements. For example, something that you didn't mention, I don't think, was a strong dependence on critical current. That can deteriorate your sample. So there are a lot of details that really need to be sorted out. So I appreciate the amount of information you've provided the community here, Michael. Great talk.
And you have to use synchrotron facilities to probe it.
Exactly.
I didn't mention much about X-ray because we have done a lot on your beam, on synchrotron, a lot of X-ray.
Okay. Thank you very much, everyone. I guess Zulu, there are no any questions. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. And thank you, Mikhail. Thank you, everyone, for to be with us. And just announcement: we have a next talk on October 18. Sakura Pascarelli from European X-ray Free Electron Laser is going to present the talk. And see you then. Bye bye.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mikhail. Thank you, everybody. Yeah.